And now, to conclude the Jazz for Bluesmen course, I would like to say a few words on where you may want to go after this. First of all, how are you going to use what you've learned in this course? In the last page of the PDF booklet, you will find a list of beginner and intermediate level jazz standards. What I suggest you do is the following. Number one, find the chord chart. And this is as simple as Googling the title of the song and the words chord chart, and print that for your reference. Number two, find a couple of versions on YouTube and familiarize yourself with the tune. As you listen, follow the chord changes on the chart you've printed. Number three, find a backing track for the tune. And again, these days, YouTube is your primary source for that. Number four, play the chords together with the backing track. Then number five, perform your harmonic analysis using the magic table and figure out what scale or scales you might be using. And eventually, number six, have a blast improvising. A different question is how you may want to expand the knowledge you have acquired in this course and tackle the really advanced techniques of jazz improvisation. This is not an easy subject for me to approach, I must say. And that is for a reason that you will probably find very strange. The problem, stated very simply, is that I don't like most of what people do with those advanced techniques. This obviously is a very personal, completely subjective judgment. Let me try to explain, however, with a short example. The video I'm going to show you is by Cheryl Bailey, an acclaimed performer and very well-known educator. Her excellent instruction courses are all over the internet. Let's listen in for a minute. What do we have here? First of all, an absolutely outstanding technique. And here, by technique, I do not mean what I meant in the early lessons of this course. Then what I meant was, you remember, the picking technique and its effects on sound. Here, I use the word technique in a more comprehensive way. Cheryl has a complete, utter domination over all the neck of the guitar. She knows exactly where every single note is. She has a mental map of all the possible arpeggios and scales, and what's really important, she knows where she wants to go with her lines well before she actually plays the notes. She is playing in the bebop style, and if I were to express the essence of what bebop is, I would say that bebop improvisation consists of two things. Number one, outlining chords, playing arpeggios. And number two, linking these chords through scale fragments and passing tones. And in this course, we've tried to make things easy by performing a harmonic analysis on songs and seeing how much ground we can cover with a limited number of scales. In the case of Autumn Leaves, we showed that you can play over the entire structure with just one scale. Bebop takes a much harder route. It treats each chord, each single chord in a song, as a single entity, and it outlines it by playing the chord tones. Root, third, fifth, seventh, as we say it many times, possibly the ninth or the 11th. And the concept so far is simple. But then what happens if I simply play arpeggios? Let's take a 2-5-1 progression in the key of C. And I play. These are arpeggios, but this is no music, okay? So the real art of bebop is the so-called voice leading. That means moving from the chord tones of one chord to the next one in a fluid, musically pleasing way. You still move from the chord tones of the first chord to the ones of the second, but you approach them, you target them. In our simple example, for example, I'm only playing chord tones, but this has become a phrase, a lick that is musically pleasing. So this is the foundation. The possibilities, as you understand, are infinite, and it takes a lifetime of study and practice to reach the level of competence somebody like Cheryl Bailey has. My problem, and I stress again that it is my personal problem, is that I find that many of these extraordinary musicians get perhaps too absorbed in the intellectual process, and something is lost in music. In my opinion, what we saw in the video is an eye-popping show of musical mastery, but it doesn't sound particularly good. To my essentially melodic ear, it's not pleasing. Even my own revered master and divine reference, George Benson, sounded not particularly pleasing to my own ear when he played torrents of notes in the solos of his early recordings. Right, enough of my bickering now. The fact, the reality is that you can greatly enhance your musical vocabulary by understanding and practicing the basic concepts of bebop improvisation. And if you want to have a go at this, I can warmly recommend a course that's available on truefire.com. And that is it for me. I really hope you've enjoyed this course. I hope it has taught you something new, and especially I hope you will have loads of fun using these simple concepts on a virtually endless selection of beautiful jazz standards. Enjoy!